Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Deconstructing My Facade presentation, Jesus reminds us of the tools required to deconstruct our facade, examines the process of deconstruction, and recommends the development of the global emotion of faith and the removal of the global emotion of refusal to experience terror and pain. Recorded on the 24th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, well, this discussion is going to be about deconstructing my facade. But before I begin this discussion, I'd just like to point out to you guys that you're closing down a bit today. Have you noticed that? You're pretty open the first few days, but closing down a bit today. Why do you reckon that is? If we have a mic down, Yvonne, thanks.
I was going to ask before, actually, whether shutting down to those two diagrams, like not being able to really take it in, is because it's just showing my resistance to truth?
And the resistance to the reality of the current state. Mm. You know, it's like we can't accept our facade until we accept the reality of where we're at right now. And I feel that while we talk about, when I talk about having compassion for your facade and not judging your facade, most of you are pretty open about that. You felt like, you know, I can see that I've been doing that and I need to stop doing that. But when it comes to actually facing the current state of the facade itself and seeing that this is where the situation we're really in right now, that's where we start closing down, isn't it? We start closing down. And whenever I discuss terror, the feeling, the emotion of terror, and pain, feeling the emotions related to pain, there's always this tendency to shut down under those circumstances as well. And then we needed to talk about governing emotion, as we did in the last group, but many of you start to get hung up on the understanding. And that then causes you to, instead of being open to the understanding, it actually shuts you down to understanding. Sort of like the more internal confusion we have, the less we're able to understand. And so we're trying harder and harder and harder, but actually the result is less and less understanding. And then once you get in a state where you feel like you're not understanding, then you start closing down emotionally as well. Like, because there's all these things of I'm now not getting it, and you know, all the childhood issues about not understanding something start coming up then, and this closes down your opportunity to be guided by your guides as well. So you know, the more closed down you become, the less able they are to influence you, to and help you to come to an understanding. So yeah, I just wanted to point that out to you that. This part of the session, this session itself, is all about removing our unloving self. And this is the part you're going to struggle with the most to stay connected and to stay sort of open emotionally. This is the start part where you start feeling like you're getting judged or you don't understand and you're making mistakes and you don't get it and it's confusing and all these areas, and that's what causes a shutdown then emotionally. So I'd just like to encourage you to stay open emotionally, like you were on the second day, you know, the second day of the group. Yeah. Teresa, you?
I've been trying to make an effort today to actually be open. Mm. And I thought I did understand that diagram. Mm-hmm. And now I'm just wondering if that's just an I'm deceiving myself on intellect.
I've got to show you this card, unfortunately. Oh. This one here. Can you see the addiction you're in?
For assurance or approval?
Yeah, what do you want? You want daddy to reassure you. I'm not your daddy. So I can't reassure you. You need to work out for yourself what the answer to your question is. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yeah. A lot of you ladies revert to that when you get all worried. You get all worried, fearful, and what happens? Daddy, tell me that it's all okay again. You know. Yeah, so, you know, can't do that for you. Okay. Well, as I said, we now come to the deconstructing my facade discussion. Of course, to deconstruct something, we need to know how it's constructed, and you know how it's constructed. The facade I'm talking about now. You know that the facade was constructed by two primary problems. It was the number one primary problem was the refusal to feel the emotion of terror, and the number two primary problem is refusing to feel our pain, right? Trying to avoid our pain, being desensitized to our pain. So we know that they are the two main reasons why we have the facade. So in terms of how to deconstruct the facade, wouldn't it make sense that if that's the two main reasons why we've got the facade, then it makes sense that one method we could use for the deconstruction of the facade is to address those two things. Sounds simple. It's hard. All right. So you'll notice in your notes you have those reminders about your facade that are really, and that's what I'm just raising now, that the reason why it got created is because we're refusing to feel this global emotion of terror that we all have. And another reason why it got created was that we're refusing to feel the pain itself. We have all these false beliefs, false definitions of love about the pain that cause us to shut down and not feel the pain. So if these are the main reasons why we have the facade, then you can see that the deconstruction of the facade is really going to be dependent on getting back to these points, isn't it? And being able to do something different with them, rather than worrying about all this stuff up here. Yeah. But as I've said, the majority of us won't even get to that point because we have to feel that point. It's not something that you can just say, oh, well, Jesus told me that I've got terror and I've got this to do, so that's what I'm going to do. It's not going to work like that. It doesn't work like that. You can have 1,000 people tell you that, and it won't work like that. How it works is that you have to get to the point internally where you feel that you feel the terror, you feel you have the terror in you, and you feel that you have the denial of pain happening in you, and you notice it happening. Now, to become sensitized to knowing that it's happening requires dealing at least with some of this, right? Deconstructing some of this. Because this is all about the tools you use to desensitize yourself to this. So when you begin, basically we're pretty desensitized to even this. In fact, for many of us, we're in total denial that we even have a problem before we begin. Now, to develop an awareness of the problem, firstly, we have to go through some phases, and that's what I'd like to remind you of. I'm not going to discuss this with you in much detail because I feel what I would like to do is give you some advice about it in this section, because we've already discussed the deconstruction process in 2014. And 1914, that'd be a bit of a problem. I wasn't even on Earth then. Yeah, but we didn't discuss the deconstruction process in the Paget messages. We did refer to it a bit, but not in a lot of detail. It's very interesting because the majority of people on Earth are very, like, opposed to even discussing anything to do with emotional pain. So you know, it's very hard. You imagine being a spirit and trying to channel information about emotional pain. It's just almost impossible. You know, so what you finish up doing as a spirit is you start talking about sort of the general principles and everything, but at the end of the day, it's very hard to share the real detail. All right. So let's have a few reminders about the process, shall we? Process of deconstruction. So the main problem is here, we sinned, it created pain. Now, of course, it makes sense. Stop sinning would be helpful, wouldn't it? If we stop sinning, then there'd be no more pain created. But the problem is that most of our sins are driven by our false beliefs and a lot of emotions within us that we feel entitled to act upon. And so we finish up creating more pain. So the removal of sin is going to be, well, it's really not the removal that we need to talk about at this point, because the removal comes, we'll talk about that tomorrow. It's the removal of the barriers to accepting the results of the sin that we need to talk about today. So what we need to do, obviously, is we need to somehow get to the stage where pain is not a problem for us, where pain is the kind of thing that we're okay with experiencing, physical and emotional pain, and spiritual pain, by the way, you're going to have. You have moral pain, spiritual pain. They're all different emotions that you experience. And we've got to get used to the fact that we're going to have them. Does that make sense? Pamela, you'd like to ask?
Can you remind me, please, what is spiritual pain?
Pretty much all of your false definitions of God are spiritual pain.
Okay.
Can you see, like, if you believe that God's a punishing God, that's a spiritual pain. A pain that affects you spiritually, your the way in which you view God has a large bearing on your ability to connect to yourself and connect to God and all those things, but it does form spiritual pain. Physical pain is more like got a pain in my back, got a pain in my tummy or whatever. Emotional pain is more like oh, you know, my dad left me or mum treated me this way or whatever. Right? Spiritual pain is all about how you believe God to be most of the time. And what you believe about love is all spiritual pain. Mm. See, what is true spirituality? Is not true spirituality development in love? So if true spirituality is development in love, then spiritual pain is all of the pains you have about your belief systems about love. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Mm. Thank you.
Yep. So obviously we have all sorts of pain which create physical, emotional and spiritual addictions. Yeah. So for example, many of you when I first met you were involved in New Age movements. Yeah. And to me that was your spiritual addiction, to avoid some truth about God, and you came to feel that you might be God or a part of God, and you know, that there's no such thing as God. It's not really God. You know, there's no person God, personality God, but rather there's a, you know, there's just, I'm a part of God, you're a part of God, we're all fragments of God. So that was one, that was a spiritual addiction, to believe that. It's a spiritual addiction in order to avoid some emotion. And what's the emotion that helps you avoid? That God neglects you. That God can't communicate with you and you're not hearing God. It helps you avoid all that, because if we're all a part of God, then we don't have to worry about that. Does that make sense? Every belief system we have is created generally by some kind of addiction. Yeah. And you can trace them all back, and you will be able to, as you work through your pain, you will be able to trace everything back. Every choice you've made, why you made it, the beliefs you've had, why you've had them, you'll be able to trace them all back. And I think that's fantastic, because you get to the stage where you go, wow, I only believe that because of this, and I only believe that because of this. And you start to really understand yourself well, which is great. Yeah. All right. Now, of course, I should mention, of course, I've skipped a bit in the outline, haven't I? Yeah, those very important tools for deconstruction of anything But you know them, right? You know what I mean when we talk about them now. So don't neglect those tools. Developing an aspiration to develop those tools is essential. Without those tools, you're not going to be able to do it. Just not. So everything we talk about in terms of deconstructing, releasing your pain, you're not going to be able to do it without those tools. You need faith. You need truth. You need to take action. You need to be humble. You need to feel your emotions. You have to do it. You got to get to a stage where you want to. And that it will, for each of you individually, be different time. You know, there'll be resistance here, resistance there. And when I say have to, what I'm saying is, no, you still got free will. You can choose to do whatever you want. But if you want a relationship with God and you want education from God and education in love, you are going to have to develop those four qualities. There's no choice about that. Every single person who I know in the celestial heavens have all developed those qualities. You read the Paget messages. You feel it in every single one, don't you? When, like, if you read messages from Luke, how passionate was he about truth? And then you go to John, and how passionate is he about truth? And then you go to Paul, and how passionate is he about truth? They've all got the same passion about it, haven't they? So what does that tell you? It tells you that every celestial being has the same passion about truth. So that tells me that I must develop a passion about truth. Does that make sense? Now, every celestial being acts. Every celestial being has faith. Every celestial being feels exactly what they feel. Right. And that tells me that I need to develop those qualities. And if I can develop those qualities, they'll stay with me. Stay with me for millennia. For the rest of my existence. What I like about it is that, as if I don't like much about it, but anyway, what I like about it is that God's designed this process in such a way that all the things that you need to develop in order to make the current transition are the exact things you're going to need for the rest of your existence. In other words, they don't disappear. Isn't that great? You know, it's not like how most man-made programs are. A lot of times, you know, they develop a program and the thing you learn in the early day, you discard later on. But all of God's stuff all builds on each other and it all has solid foundation. Yeah. Right, so we're talking about the process. So the process is quite simple because if we examine our little diagram here, we examine our diagram, we can see that we really have two possible choices. We know that pain was created from sin, and then the false beliefs and the false definitions of love are a part of what creates our pain. And then we've got the terror. We know that these two things are the reason why we created the facade. Right? So these are our primary driving forces. So it makes sense that if we're going to deconstruct my facade, I'm going to have to address at some point those two things, aren't I? I'm going to have to get to a willingness to address them. I don't have to actually do it yet because that would be then releasing my pain. But to deconstruct it, I'm going to have to look at my motivations to keep these in place, these beliefs in place. That's one choice. The other choice is that I start from the top down and go down. So in other words, I start with my denial and I work through my denial. Then I go through all the things I want satisfaction from, all my addictions, and then I look at how I get angry and that tells me what my addictions are, and I'll go through my addictions one by one, slowly removing them, and get to the point where now I come face to face with the fact that I've got all these addictions and my facade is all about satisfying them. And I get to the point where I'm now accepting my facade. And once I've accepted my facade, which of course I still need to do to get to these, once I accept my facade, now I've got the opportunity of getting to the pain. So you could say one part is sort of accepting that I have all this. Now, as I've said, for the majority of us, we do begin in denial. So for the majority of us, we don't know that this is here. Emotionally, we don't know. You're just listening to me say it is. But you don't know for yourself that it's there. Does that make sense? You haven't touched it yet. You don't know it's there. And when it comes to this pain, most of you don't know it's there either. You've desensitized yourself to it. So for you, it's like it's not there. Does that make sense? It's not there yet. You can't feel it yet. So no matter how much I talk about it, if you don't feel it, then you're first going to have to go through a process of getting to the stage where you finish up feeling it. Does that make sense to you? Yeah? Now, that process of deconstruction of anything is the same process that we listed in our 2014 talk, which was, firstly, go through the intellectual process of deconstruction, right? All right, so now that process begins with denial, intellectual, emotional denial and intellectual denial. So now for most of you, you weren't in that place of complete denial when I first met you. Because you wouldn't even met me if you had have been. Do you follow me? I'm talking about a whole heap of things that wouldn't interest a person who's in complete denial. Yep. So that tells me that the majority of you have gone through some of the process of intellectual awareness, even before we met, where you felt like, things are not right, I'd like to know what's going on in my life, and I'm interested in some spiritual matters, and I want to know what's happening, and I want to discover more and feel about more, and this guy who's claiming he's Jesus says that he knows what's going on, so I might just go along to that and listen and see whether he knows what's going on, right? That very first time. That you regret coming to. I have plenty of people say that to me. I regret ever meeting you. Mm. Yeah, because they get to the point of acceptance of their facade and
bingo.
Got to come up with some excuses then. But for many of you, even those people who got to that point of, you know, accepting their facade and then went off again, they went through a process of some intellectual deconstruction because they had some intellectual awareness that they wanted to find something new, something more. There was something missing. Does that make sense? And that requires a bit of openness intellectually, at least. So we go through the process of intellectual deconstruction. Now, I've listed that process on your handout, so I'm not going to be listing it on the board. We've discussed it in detail in the first presentation in 2014. My suggestion is to go back to that presentation and have a look at that process. When we first discussed that process with you, the majority of you were totally confused. And when you look at it again, you're probably totally confused. So my suggestion is, study it. Study it and attempt to understand it, because it's going to require some understanding on your part to understand what's going on. Does that make sense? Yeah. I don't want to discuss that too much because I want to focus my attention on what recommendations I would like to make to you. So that's why I don't want to cover too much material about going over that, regurgitating that material we've already given you. But the intellectual process of deconstruction is going to be required for you to at least be open to begin to work through the emotional process of deconstruction. Because if you don't get to a place of intellectual awareness that something is wrong, then you're never probably going to choose to take an emotional path that might feel painful and difficult. You're never going to do that, right? So the intellectual part of it is an important part of it. And it's not the end of it, of course, but it is the beginning of it. It needs to happen. And it gets you out of intellectual denial. In other words, it gets you to the stage where you realise, yeah, there is something wrong here. And, you know, logically, you start to see things a bit more logically. Like, logically, if God exists, then there probably is laws. And logically, you know, if the fact that we have law of gravity and then we have the law of, you know, aerodynamics, logically, if we have a spiritual body, then there must be a whole heap of laws that pertain to that. And logically, if we have a soul, there must be a whole heap of laws pertaining to that. So what happens in this intellectual awareness process is you start, and the intellectual deconstruction, you start becoming intellectually aware that there must be things that you don't understand yet. And that's a part of building humility, isn't it? Understanding that there's things you don't know. Right? Rather than believing that you know everything or that it's impossible to know everything. It's far better to understand, well, no, we can know everything, but that's going to require a process of discovery. So once we've done this intellectual deconstruction process, and sometimes we do it for individual things, you know, like, so when I first met the majority of you, whenever I said the first word, the word God, most of you had a meltdown. You did. You go back to the time. You think, God, what is he talking about God for? Yeah, as long as he's talking about God being me, then I'm okay. But as soon as that's not the case, and I don't mean me, Jesus, I mean me in terms of each one of us is God. As long as that's the case, you know, I'll let him get away with it type of thing. But for the majority of you, when I started talking about God, you did have quite a large amount of resistance about even the word, if you look back at the time when we first met. And now I talk about God and you don't throw anything at me or anything. It's like, pretty amazing. There's some progress. You see, that's a part of that intellectual awareness process that maybe there is a God. At this stage, many of you don't feel there is still because the feelings come from childhood things that have happened, you see. So many of you don't feel there is yet with all your heart, but you realise that, you know, there is the potential that that is true, and so that lets you discover more. So the intellectual process is very important. Now I'm just going to have a cough, sorry. So here we are, we're now in this process where we feel open to the possibilities and we are aware that there must be also some emotions within us that probably need to be addressed before we can really accept something. So for example, with the question of God, you know, God's existence and even talking about God. Initially, we were pretty resistive to even hearing the word God, and that was due to quite a lot of personal experiences in the past relating to God. In other words, and when I say relating to God, relating to what people teach you about God. So, you know, for most of us who are part of a Christian faith, if we were, you know, there's a lot of negative things about God, isn't there? God's used to manipulate you and tell you what to do and all these other things, so there's feelings there. And then, you know, if God's like my parents, then who wants God type of feeling that we have, because we see God as a position of authority and power over us. And then we also generally have injuries regarding, well, does God have any power at all? Because God doesn't seem to do anything on the planet. And, you know, look at all the harm that's happening to children. And, you know, one of my mother's favourite things is like, all these children are being harmed. Yeah, what's God doing about it? Nothing. Now she goes to a religious faith and that's what she feels. So you can see how, you know, there's a lot of emotion in even just in the word God. So many of you have had to begin to tolerate that emotion. In other words, you've become a bit more sensitive that the emotion is there, haven't you, over this period of time? It's taken 6 or 7 years, but you've got a bit more sensitive to the idea that the emotion is there. It doesn't have to be that slow, by the way, but, you know, this is how we go. And we're a bit more sensitive that emotion is there, and then we're starting to feel, well, you know, maybe there is a God and maybe there is laws and maybe the reason why God can't communicate is because of different laws and what we've chosen to do and how we resist it and all that. Maybe that's a possibility. At this stage, just a possibility, because it's still an intellectual process we're in. So it's not something we believe, it's only something we feel might be right. Isn't that the case? And that's how people, once they get to this stage of accepting their facade, they can walk away because they've heard all that, but it's still not here. It's only here. And the trouble with something that only in your mind and not yet in your heart is that you can walk away from it. You can. But it's a necessary part of the process. It's a part of the process that has to happen, otherwise here won't ever happen. Letting it here won't ever happen. But letting it here is a very, very different process than letting it here. Very different process. And this is where most of us have deep levels of confusion. Because we're trying to use the same method that we got it there to get it there. And it's not going to work. To get it there, all we had to do is sit with it, reason about it, logically look at it, listen to more material about it, answer all of our intellectual questions about it so that all of our questions are explained. If our questions are explained, then it's more highly likely to be true. We've asked a lot of logical questions about it, all from our mind mostly, and then that allays that fear, and then we ask another question and it says, oh yeah, well that makes sense, I can accept that, and then ask another question and we go, oh that makes sense, so I can sort of accept that and see that. And we go through this process of developing an intellectual awareness of the thing, don't we? But it still doesn't mean it's here. And unless it's here, you're definitely going to be able to walk away from it. And that's why the people who hit the facade, hit the acceptance of the facade point, when all these really hard emotions start getting triggered, that's why it's so easy for them to leave at that point, because the truth isn't in their heart yet, and at the same time as that, their heart is getting triggered with all this negative emotion. So can you see what's happening? There's no positive acceptance of truth in their heart yet, but at the same time there's all this stuff about, you know, anger and frustration and rage about addictions not getting met, all getting triggered. That's your point of danger, as we've pointed out already. But let's say we get to the point where now we've broken down and come to the point where, yes, there's a high likelihood that what Jesus is talking about is actually true, but I've yet to personally experience it. Now, many of you have got to that point where you think it's probably true, but you're yet to personally experience it, right? So what's the next phase? Well, the next phase is the emotional deconstruction process, isn't it? The emotional deconstruction process. Well, now, this is a lot more complicated, isn't it? Because the intellectual deconstruction process is the same way that we intellectually analysed anything in our lives prior to now. So, you know, when we went to school, we were taught this intellectual process of reason, logic, answering, asking questions, answering questions, and so forth, till we get to the point of what we call understanding in our mind. And that's what all of us have done. And many of you have done that through your school life. How many have been to university? Maybe one third to one half. And you've done it there as well. Right? You've had to do it there to learn. That's the way you've learned. But the problem with that kind of learning is that it's not the kind of learning that you need for your soul. And nobody's ever taught you how to learn at the soul. And so the problem with that then becomes that all of God's stuff, all of the truth, all of the truths of the universe, and the truths of the universe now I'm talking about that go from the sixth dimension onwards, which is where we'd like to head, right? All of those truths are dependent upon understanding at the soul level. So we're going to have to learn how to learn with our soul. Does that make sense? And this is the thing you've been resisting, learning with your soul, right? Rather than with your head. Now, learning with your soul requires emotional processing. And that's why we find it so difficult, because we have a global problem with emotion, right? And this is why it's difficult for us to grasp it. Now, if I had a group of five-year-olds here, I would be able to teach them how to feel emotion probably within 1 week at the maximum. Right? At the maximum. Now, why is that? Because they are already closer to the point of feeling emotion. They've not got all of the layers of facade and layers of terror and pain, you know, and particularly they have that, of course, but they don't have many of these yet established, particularly intellectually established. So it's quite easy for them to. And in fact, what we found with Eloise's children, because we've had a bit to do with them, you know, I can sit with them and just hold them for a few minutes and they're already in their emotion. Don't even have to say anything. So you know how you've got the emotion of rebellion in you. And the majority of you have that, right? You just love to rebel against law. But you know, to trigger that in a child, all you've got to do is hold their arms, hold their legs and sit them on your lap. But I'm not going to do that with you. Because you'd be kicking and screaming and I'll probably get hurt or even killed in the process, right? But a five-year-old, you can do that, right? And it triggers their feeling of rebellion. Eventually they get into the sadness. Yeah. I remember a little tacker who was in the back of a car and the parents wanted to take him out because he was screaming and yelling all the time. And I said, just leave him there. Strap him in. So they strapped him in. He screamed and yelled and threw things for about 2 hours. And then after that, he got into crying and he got into repentance. And within 3 hours, he was done. After that, he was a dream to travel with in the back. Yeah. That's how it works, you know. For a child, it's quite simple because a child hasn't got all of that intellectual layer to deconstruct and hasn't got all these blockages to the emotion either. Right? But we're adults, so we're going to have to go through a process here. Can you see that? We're going to have to go through a process of relearning how to have a soul-based awareness process. And that is the emotional deconstruction process. It's a soul-based process. Now, I've listed that soul-based process in your outline. Right? There's seven or so steps in that soul-based process, starting with the emotional denial, and then a developing emotional awareness and so forth. Now, my suggestion to you is to really settle yourself and study that information about the process, okay? Because that's the process you've lost naturally. Now, that process is natural in a young child. It's quite easy to teach. But for adults, it's quite difficult because we've got all these reasons why we shouldn't do it, all that we've established beforehand. But it has to be done because, as I said to you earlier in our Q&A, I think it was it in our Q&A? It might not have been, but it might have been this morning in the homework session, that, remember, the soul communicates with God's soul only as a soul-to-soul communication. It doesn't go via language and intellect, right? So soul-to-soul. So if you want to receive information from God, which is the goal here, isn't it? We're here because we want to receive an education in love, and that only can come from God. The world's view of love, totally distorted. So we need to get the education from God. And the only way we can get the education from God is through soul-to-soul communication. So we need to learn how to do it. That's all we need to do, learn how to do it. Now, most of you have been getting real self-punishing about that process and frustrated with yourself and annoyed with yourself and annoyed with me and annoyed with anybody you can, really. You know, sometimes you've gone into rebellion and so forth about the process, but it's just a process of learning something that you don't or no longer know how to do, that's all. And it's going to take some time. It's going to take some time because the whole world is opposed to you doing it. And currently you're opposed to doing it, otherwise you would already be doing it. So currently you're opposed, and then the world's opposed, and then the spirits around you are opposed, so, you know, it's like, who's not opposed? Jesus. He's not opposed to you doing it, right? But he's one of billions. And that's one reason why you haven't done it yet, is because you want the billions to come along for the ride so that you won't be attacked by the billions in order to get it done. Isn't that the case? Many of you are waiting for your families to come along, your friends to come along. You're hoping that they will at some point in the future. But honestly, they're not going to until they notice the benefits of it. And the only way they're going to notice the benefits of it is if you do it and you show them the benefits of it. That's the only way they're going to do it, probably. And like I said, they're the first ones that are going to oppose you anyway, because they have a different idea of what truth is and have a different idea of what love is, and of course they're going to oppose it initially. Oh, I don't have a single member of my family in the first century who didn't oppose it. Eventually they all came around. Eventually. For some it was like hundreds of years it took, but most of them, a lot of them did it after I died and were, you know, came back to them afterwards. My mum, my brothers, most of them. My two sisters, no, they took longer. They were in the spirit world before they did it. But my brothers, they did it then. My mother did it then. My father did it after I died. Most of the disciples did it after I died. But they all did it, even given the opposition, right? Okay, so we need to study that process. So what I'm recommending to you is study the emotional process. That's the bit you're not getting. That's the bit you need to get. The intellectual process is something that you become aware of, and it's something you've done quite naturally, but it's the emotional process that you're not allowing. And so we need to stop having so much judgment about the emotional process and actually start addressing this emotional process. This is how you learn from God's perspective. So like I said, I can tell you that you have all this global refusal of pain, this terror of pain inside of you, but until you feel that you do, you're not going to do anything about it. And I'm not saying that you've got to try to feel you do. I'm saying you've got to go through a process, you've got to choose to go through a process that eventually will highlight that you do. And once you highlight that you do, then you'll know it's there, and then it's just up to you whether you choose to feel it or not. But you're not going to be able to feel it while you believe it's not there. Right? And that's a personal experience. Nothing I say to you is going to help you get to the stage, you know, force you to the stage where you believe it's there. It's a will-based process on your own part that will cause you to see that it's there, that you choose to engage for yourself, just like I've had to choose to engage it for myself. And you won't see your false beliefs about love. I can tell you what they are, but you still won't see them until you start feeling some of this pain. Once you start feeling the pain, you go, ah, there it is. Like, wow, I thought I didn't have that. You know, I thought I didn't have that, but now that I've felt, I can feel that I do. And then you can go through the emotional process of releasing that. Does everyone get that? The emotional process is essential, and this is why I wanted to remind you of that. Okay? Okay. Is there any questions about that? G'day. So the process of deconstruction, two phases, the intellectual process, the emotional process, and most of you are pretty comfortable with the intellectual process and very uncomfortable with the emotional process. And we've got to help you get to the stage where you're comfortable with the emotional process. Does that make sense? Where you really, you want to do it and you feel like you have to do it and you know you've got to do it and you can feel inside of you that it's there, and we've got to help you get to that stage. So part of that process is to firstly introduce you to the material, and then the next part of that process is to answer all of your questions about this phase, right? And this is why we want to have next year, what we're thinking of doing is not having any of these groups for a year and instead having Q&As every week at our studio where you've sent in questions about the phase. Does that make sense? And we can talk more about all of your questions, answer them all. So remember, I just earlier mentioned the situation with God, how when I first talked about God, I said, you know, talk to you about God, and God was like, yeah, it's a four-letter word, not a three-letter one, right? You just didn't want to hear about it. And what caused you to allow yourself to hear more was you had questions, which you asked, and I answered, and then you asked and I answered, and you asked and I answered. In that process, you became more open to the truth of it, right? Of God's existence. And what I'm suggesting to you is you're going to need to go through that process with the truth about your emotional soul-based process itself, the deconstruction process itself. You're going to have to find out more about it and desire to find out more about it before you'll do it. And you'll need to go through the process of allaying all of your intellectual fears, really, about doing it. And then once you get to a point where you've satisfied yourself that that particular process is worth doing, then you'll do it. But it's only when you satisfy yourself that it's worth doing that you'll do it. Yeah. And I can tell you too, I'm blue in the face, that it's good to do and that I've done it and it's had major benefit to myself and so forth. Makes no difference, won't make any difference to you. You're going to need to get to that point yourself. That's the exercise of your will. That makes sense to you, right? Yeah. And that's a personal choice, getting to that place. And it will be different speed for all of you as to when you'll get there. And it'll depend largely on your desire to get there, to that point, and also how open you are to ask questions about that process. Right? Now, you'll notice that the majority of your questions have been about your emotions. For the last 7 years, isn't that the case? The majority of your questions. So what does that tell you? That the majority of your fear is associated with emotions. And for many of you, you've been asking question after question after question about emotions without ever actually feeling an emotion. Because you're intellectually at the point where you're still afraid to actually feel an emotion. Right, so at some point there's got to be this swing from this direction that you're taking, which is I'll ask more questions about emotion, and hopefully one day something magical will happen and all of a sudden I'll start feeling one. Right? And what I'm suggesting to you is the choice to feel an emotion is actually a will-based choice. It's not a magical process. So that's going to require a switch in you, isn't it? An attitude switch internally towards allowing yourself to desire emotion and to feel it. That makes sense, doesn't it? An attitude switch is going to have to happen. Paul, you wanted to ask.
To me, it seems like a discipline. With other things which I've done, and for myself, it seems like, is that how you have experienced it?
No, I feel this is where, see how you've learned intellectually does not have a bearing on how you'll feel your emotions. The process of learning intellectually is often a disciplined process. You are given material, you study it, you take the effort and time to study it, you remember it. It's a process of an intellectual process of discipline. I agree. But that's not the process of soul-based awareness. The process of soul-based awareness is a process of surrender.
I guess I'm talking around fear and I guess for myself.
I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want it to be discipline, Paul, and the majority do. The majority want the process, the soul-based process, to be the same as the intellectual process that they've learned over years, right? Because it's easier, so you think. But you haven't tried the soul-based process to know if it's easier. You just think it's going to be easier. But the surrender process, which is the real process, right, which is a process of becoming humble, truly humble, that process requires emotion. The discipline process does not require emotion. It requires what I would classify as willpower. Does that make sense? Whereas this process requires will. Very, very different processes. This process needs will. This process, you use willpower. This process is surrender to emotion. This process doesn't worry about emotion. You don't have to worry about emotion there. You just have to remember things. Right. This process requires going through pain. This process allows you to avoid pain.
See, with going into fear and for me, mm-hmm. putting the time and stuff, you know, and I'm like I'm frequently in the middle of the night, you know, up feeling fear.
Yeah.
And sometimes I get some relief and I feel like I've gone through some and then I can go back to sleep and
yep.
have some peace. And other times I don't feel like I can get to that point. And,
yeah.
And but that to me is something, you see, or I can just lie in bed thinking, oh, I wish I could just go to sleep. But to me it seems, and sometimes I liken it
to... But can I suggest to you, Paul, you don't want to surrender to anger. And you've got quite a lot of it to feel. You don't want to feel it, right? And you definitely don't like surrendering to grief, right? And you definitely don't like surrendering to shame. And I could probably list another 10 or 15 emotions that I know you don't like feeling. Now, while your will is exercised in trying to shut those emotions down, will surrender ever occur? No matter how much you get up in the middle of the night and just try to feel. See, I suggest you're using your willpower.
Yeah.
Yeah. And your will isn't set yet because you've not let go of the reason why you don't want to do it. Can everyone see that? It's like for most of you, you're yet to let go of the reasons why you don't want to do it. You think you want to do it, so you're going to force yourself to do it. Does that make sense to you? This is what you're doing. You think you want to do it, so you're going to force yourself to do it. Whereas my focus has been, why don't I want to do it? Because it'll happen naturally if I want to do it. The fear will come up naturally, as it did for myself, when I wanted to do it. When in my emotions, I wanted to do it. That's when it came up. Didn't come up before then. I was in complete denial of it for years and years and years. Now, and you can't force yourself to do it. You have to want to do it. And that's about developing the aspiration and working through all the reasons why you don't want to do it. And that's why I see the majority of you don't want to do. You don't want to work through the don't want to. Does that make sense? You're telling yourself you want to. But you don't want to. And you're better off feeling why you don't want to. Because every feeling that you have that you don't want to will get released if you feel it. And the less feelings of don't want to that are in you will cause you to eventually do it. Do you see? So it's sort of like the way I see it for the majority of you, and this is how I see it for yourself, Paul, is that you sort of, if you imagine this is a container, and this is your don't want to container. Don't do it. That's your don't do it container, okay? Other way around. That's your don't do it container. And your don't do it container is full of different emotions that just say don't do it, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Right? Now, while the don't do it container is full, and the do it container, here's the do it container, is quite low, you know, you've got a bit of faith, that's good. You feel like you've learnt enough about the truth now to think you want to do it. So your thoughts, so you've got some faith. But it's not strong enough yet to overcome the don't do it. And you've got some thoughts about doing it, but still not strong enough to overcome don't do it. Can you see it's not going to happen? The only way it's going to happen, isn't it, is that if each of these don't do it emotions start to get released, while at the same time you build this with other things, truth, action, and so forth, right? Now, can you see, for the majority of you, you've been trying to build that while at the same time holding on to this and not releasing it. And that's what you've been doing, Paul. You try to build this, what you call the positives of life, that will get you to do something, while at the same time, so these are emotions. I'm not saying many of these are emotional, because your faith is emotional. So you have some faith and it's emotional. But those emotions are still not powerful enough to overcome the don't do it emotions, because you've yet to release the don't do it emotions. The more of these that you release, can you see that once this level here, the don't do it level, gets below the do it level, what's going to happen? You'll do it. That makes sense? You'll do it. Your desire now to do it is greater than your fear of not doing it. You could say this scale here is your fear level, couldn't you? And you could say this scale here is your desire level.
Yeah, another thing with the fear level thing, because I sort of tell myself that I'm processing fear throughout the day, whereas the truth might be more that I'm living in my fear. And how have you known the difference in that? Is that the same desire? And
I've already described that a couple of days ago when I talked about I was just completely locked up, passing out, breathing deeply for hours at a time. But I couldn't work during the day while I'm in that state.
I guess I'm just talking about in every day, like being connected to how I feel around people and stuff like that.
I'm talking about the same thing as you. See, this is the thing, is that we're talking about the same thing, but you don't think we are. And the reason why you don't think we are is because and I feel most people have this idea, is like, what? AJ's telling me that I'm probably going to be in bed in a contorted state for hours at a time, and then I'll be feeling my fear. And that's exactly what I'm telling you. And you don't want to hear that. What you want to hear is, I can walk around working and I'll feel a little bad, but I'll be right, and I'll be feeling my fear. Type it. That's what you want to hear. And that's not what it's like. Like, if I'm feeling my sadness, I can't work. I can't do anything. I can't eat. I can't do anything. It's just I'm crying. And I'm crying. Sometimes I cry 6 hours straight. I'm crying. I can't do anything else. Right? So people walk around, they go, oh, I'm really feeling my sadness today. I go, what? Like, I'm bedridden feeling my sadness and you're walking around still working and you're telling me you're feeling your sadness? Definitely not. You're in your sadness. You're probably living in your sadness that day. Definitely not releasing it. To release it, you're going to go through a cathartic emotional process. You follow? And most of you have a terrible terror of that process. You don't want to touch that. So when I say to you, like, how are you going to cope with your life? Some of you have jobs, right? Most of you probably have jobs, right? And how are you going to cope with your life if all of a sudden you start processing terror and all of a sudden you're flopping around on the ground in your job? Yeah. Well, you know, when you think back to the Robert James Lee's book again, where we talked about the harvest of jealousy, she told a story, she started connecting emotionally, bang, she passes out. She's laying on the ground, passed out. When you're really feeling stuff, this is how you're going to be. And what does the world think of that? Good luck with that in front of a whole group of people. What will happen? Not only will you get fired, you get taken to hospital or a psychiatric ward, right? You will, if you did it there. And this is why you don't do it. It's one of the reasons. Because you know that the whole world's going to have a meltdown around you if you do it in front of them. And this is why I recommend to you that you don't do it in front of anyone. But that means you're going to have a lot of alone time, doesn't it? And you're going to let yourself get to the stage where you can feel this kind of intensity of emotion alone and without stressing out that you're going to die and without stressing out that, you know, that someone's going to cart you away into an asylum and so forth. That's why most of you are not doing it. You follow? So I feel the don't do it emotions are still driving the majority of people. They are developing some desire. So many of you are developing some desire. But the desire still isn't intense enough to overcome the don't do it emotions. So these emotions are going to, the level of these are going to have to drop, aren't they? You're going to have to process some emotion in order to get to the stage where your desire overcomes your fear. The desire has to overcome your fear before you'll do it. All right? And I'm saying to you that every single person, every single one of you that has some grief about something, you will cry for hours on end. Now about that one thing, you will. Now, you think of all the people in your life right now and how they're going to react to that. I don't know too many people are not going to react badly, huh? And you know that. That's why you haven't done it, one of the reasons. Yeah. Does that help, Paul?
Oh, for sure. You know, one thing I have to watch, see, because in my mind I think that you've gone hard, but not a hard in a disciplined way.
I've surrendered.
Yeah.
Surrendered.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every day I remind myself to be humble, and by that I mean every day I remind myself, whatever emotion I'm feeling, I need to surrender to it. I need to surrender to it. I need to just allow it to come up. I need to have the time, the energy for it to come up. I need to have the time, the circumstances for it to come up. And you know that if you're working full time, you're probably going to have to restructure your workload. You probably are, in order to allow emotion to come up, to choose to allow it to come up. Do you know what I mean? You're going to have to, years and years ago I talked about creating a soul space for your own development. That's what I meant. You're going to have to allow it to occur. You're going to have to get a job where you can do it, where you can do two or three days a week where you're allowed to feel what you feel. That's what you're going to have to do. And that's all a part of it. That's all a part of getting to the stage where you really want to do it. But I suggest to you that if you don't let go of the emotion saying, I don't want to, then no matter, you're going to have to build this to intense, aren't you, before you will overcome those emotions. And you can see that the majority of people get build this up, but they don't get it built enough before they just spit the dummy. You know, and I suppose I should explain that for overseas people. Spitting the dummy means I give up. And I say, and I'm angry, and I give up, and I just say, no, I'm not going to do it. Yeah. When I come down to Kel.
I didn't flop on the floor this morning.
Yeah.
But I feel like I had a bit of a process around this where I was angry and I was just feeling where I've judged myself for feeling angry because all my life I've been very angry and in a rage you know, and that's how I've responded to everything.
Yeah.
And so I've been in a lot of judgment about myself for being angry. And so as soon as I started to feel and want to feel why I was feeling angry,
yeah,
straight away I started to get emotional about how I felt,
yeah,
for being angry all my life and feeling humiliated every, yeah, time I got angry. And so I had it, you know.
You're allowed to get angry.
Yeah, yeah.
Just don't sin when you're angry.
Yeah. Well, that's a bit late, but anyway, but so it's good.
Do you see what I'm saying, yeah, when I mean don't sin? Don't choose to do further harm,
yes,
while you're angry.
Yes.
You need to let yourself be angry because you are going to get angry. You, yeah, guys are going to get angry.
Yeah.
You're going to get angry with God, angry with me, angry with your partner, angry with whomever tells you you should feel something.
Yeah.
You're just going to get angry. You need to go through this anger because it's a part of breaking down some of the addictions that you have.
Mm.
And you get to the stage where you realize actually the reason why I'm really angry is because I don't want to do it God's way.
Mm.
I don't. I don't want to have to do it emotionally. Why don't we want to have to do it emotionally? Most of the time, the reason why we don't want to have to do it emotionally is because we're afraid of what everybody else will do with us when we do it emotionally.
Mm.
So it's actually about fear, a lot of our anger.
Yeah.
That fear that we just don't want to feel. But you see, you have to go through that to know,
yeah,
what it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let yourself be angry. Don't sin.
Mm.
Take, you know, be angry and, you know, honestly, you might pay to have a little smashing thing outside, you know. Just that you can just go berserk, go berserk, getting angry, just really connect with it. Because what I find generally, if you really connect with your anger within 30 to 60 seconds, it usually turns into some tears.
Yeah.
And then you start feeling afraid of, you know, the fear that's there. Yeah.
Hmm.
Dave, thanks.
You mentioned earlier about how when we first met you, there was some sort of awareness that all this was taking place or wasn't quite right. Does that then mean that we had some qualities of faith, truth, action and humility, probably more seeking truth perhaps?
Seeking truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if that's the case, can we use what we had or perhaps still have
and
build on that?
You still are. You're still using it, Dave. You wouldn't be here if you weren't. So you're still using the seeking of truth as a motivation to be here. The problem is that you've also got to seek humility. And that is a very, very different kettle of fish for most of us, seeking humility. Because humility, remember, is the desire and to experience all of our emotions, whether they're positive or negative, whether they're, you know, whether they're hard or not hard to experience, whether they're pleasurable or painful. And for the majority of us, we still haven't developed humility in that regard. We're still fighting our emotions, trying to deny them, trying to suppress them, trying to keep control of them and so forth. And this is what we do need to, that's why I say it's a process of surrender, not a process of discipline, because you have to learn how to surrender to emotion. It's like, and it's, you could call it softening to emotion if you want to call it that, but to me it's a lot more than that. It's about being emotionally connected at every single moment, allowing the connection to be there in its full power and capacity. So if that means you're feeling a negative emotion, a painful emotion, then you'll allow that be there in its full capacity. And for the majority of you, you're terrified of that. And not even just terrified of it for your own capacity to feel it, but a lot of you are terrified of it because of what everyone else will think about it and what they'll say about it, what they'll do about it and how they react to it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can I ask as well?
Sure you can.
So in a sense, like the surrender is opposite of what we tend to do, and what the intellect generally does is doing, doing, doing.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, many of you are willpowering, still trying to willpower your way into a disciplinary sort of a process that's going to eventually get you to an emotion. And what I'm suggesting is that it's not going to get you to an emotion. The way you get to an emotion is by surrendering to the process, by accepting where you're at and then starting to allow yourself to feel about where you're at in a truthful manner. and to feel it and experience it emotionally. That's the surrender process, which is a completely different process. And the way you've learnt in the past, the intellectual way you've learnt in the past, all of you have been taught that we've been taught that for millennia, that way of learning on the planet. It's inbuilt in us to teach other people that way. But the reality is it's not a part of our soul. It's just the way, it's the error that's been propagated over and over again. Yeah. So it's a surrender process, and the surrender process is probably what I'd like to talk to you about now. So these are some recommendations I'd like to make to you in this discussion. And I'm going back to some very things I've said before, but I just want to make sure that you get what I'm saying to you. The first thing I'd recommend to you, global emotion. There's two global emotions you need to focus on, right? First global emotion is faith. Faith. Without faith, you will not do this. You will not. So how do you develop faith? The way you develop faith is by finding out, initially, by finding out more about God and more about God's truth and more about God's goodness and more about God's laws. That's how you develop faith. But once you've found out, the key is to put it into practice. Then you'll have some faith. See, it's one thing to talk about it, quite another to put it into practice in your life, because when you put it into practice, that's when you really have faith. That's when you really know it's going to work. Do you follow me? So what you need to do is allow yourself to experiment with some of God's laws to prove to yourself the truth of them. Like the law of cause and effect, the law of attraction. You know, these laws that you know basic things about already, put them into practice and see whether they are true or not. This will help you build your faith in God and God's goodness. Does that make sense? Allow yourself to develop your faith through a process. It's going to take you doing something, not just talking about it. To do this, to develop faith, you're going to have to do something and then measure its results. So it's like undertaking a series of experiments. Like the way I was brought up in the first century in an environment where basically the concept of God was very simple, and it's pretty much the same as the concept of God now, interestingly enough. And that is that God is just a punishing God, and what you've got to do is you've got to do whatever you can to make God not punish you. That was the concept of God. Now, the only thing that caused me to have a different concept of God was me experimenting with some opposite ideas that maybe God's good. Does that make sense? And what happens if I stop giving God all those things my mum and dad want me to give God? So what happens if I don't do a sacrifice? You know, in the first century, we had to sacrifice a lamb and eat the lamb. You know, Passover, we had to eat the lamb as a part of the acknowledgement of God and so forth, and the knowledge of God's angel protecting us. And I chose to not eat the lamb. What do you think the family felt about that? So, this is like my dad and me, just major problem about that one issue, you know, like. But I chose to not eat the lamb. You know why I chose? Because I thought that eating meat, I had to stop eating meat. I went to the temple when I was 13. We've just come back from Egypt back to Nazareth, where we finished up living. And my father went to Jerusalem, one of the very first things he did at Passover time. And I went to the temple, and there's all this blood running down the sides of the temple. It's terrible. Smelt to high heaven, as you can imagine, all these animals getting slaughtered. It just smelt like a slaughterhouse. And the pain of the animals is like screaming and whatever, carry on. And after seeing that was it for me. I couldn't eat meat anymore. So come Passover, which was the reason why we were there, I'm not eating the Passover meal. My father is just saying how I was going to get punished and it was a wicked thing I was doing, and it went on, you know. And at the end of the day, was I punished? No, I wasn't. So that helped me see that actually the only person that was punishing me was my father. Right? not God. God wasn't punishing me. So that helped me see. I can not sacrifice meat and not eat meat and not eat the Passover meal even, something which was built inside of the Jewish way of life at the time. And God didn't punish me. What else wouldn't God punish? Try a few other things that was the standard way of living and see what else would happen. You see, you've got to do the experiments. And once you've done the experiments, your faith starts developing. You say, no, that's not true. So then I could have these arguments with people. I say, sorry, that's not true. I haven't eaten the Passover meal for 20 years. And the only person that's ever harmed me for it were people on earth. God never did, you know. So you start experimenting. You start experimenting with God's goodness, experimenting with God's laws, experimenting with the different things that you need to learn about. This builds your faith. Once you built some faith, and you know, I used to experiment with John, my cousin John the Baptist, and he was a medium. You know, right from a young age, he was like some of the kids you see nowadays. You know, talk to spirits all the time. He was like that when he was little. Everybody thought he was a bit nutters, but I could see him talking to the spirits, so I didn't see he was nutters. So we used to get together and we used to sit down and we used to talk to all these different kinds of spirits to work out what they were saying. We'd ask them about this and ask them about that and look at their condition. It was wonderful. In the process, I learned that, you know, that most of the people who were punishing other people on earth were spirits in the spirit world, you know, who people thought were God. You know, so I learned a lot about that. So it's through experimentation. Do you see? You need to experiment to develop faith, but faith needs to be developed. The next global quality, humility. Remember, humility is all about emotion. Right? Not quite all about emotion, but to a large extent, it's about the willingness to feel and experience all of your emotions. So that's the next quality. It's a personal quality. Only you can develop these things. So. You know, the key is to, again, do the same thing. You develop humility through an experience, and that is softening to emotion, working through, allowing yourself to feel. Now, the average person on this planet's not going to let you do that. They're not. You can be in front of them crying, and they'll be doing all sorts of things to stop you, right? Unless you've gone to a psychologist and you're sitting down in a chair or something. And then it's okay. To a point. You know, but the rest of the time it's not okay. And when somebody attacks you, the average response on the planet is anger, is it not? You try crying instead when somebody attacks you. It's just an experiment, isn't it? Try crying instead, see what happens. You'll find some interesting things about people if you do that. But that softening, see, the average person when they're attacked wants to attack in return. That's not humble. Softening to how you feel is humble. Allow yourself to feel how you feel is humble. Right? So you'll need these qualities if you're going to deconstruct the facade. If you're going to settle with getting into these emotional process where you're willing to feel these things, you'll need to develop these qualities. These are positive qualities. They're global emotions that will affect your development. You can see two of them relate to emotion and faith, which we've already discussed in the first group, and we're discussing again now. Very important qualities. Right? You can see that truth is also an essential, a desire for truth is an essential quality, isn't it? Global thing that you can develop. I want to know the truth. I want to know the truth. I don't know the truth. I want to know it. I want to know it. No matter what, I want to know it about myself. About myself, I want to know it. Yeah. So we develop humility. We develop faith. We develop these global emotions. And then there's a negative global emotion that we're working towards here, isn't there? And the negative global emotion is being able to get to the stage where we're sensitive to and able to feel terror without running away from it. because that's the don't do it scale. You see, the don't do it scale is all about terror. We want to reduce our terror while at the same time increasing our desire. So we want to do that so that our desire on this hand gets to the stage where it overcomes any stuff, any fears. And as a result of our desire overcoming our fears, now we act, and we act naturally. And once you get to that stage, you'll feel emotion naturally. You will. You won't do it necessarily in every situation, because the situation you're in, it may actually be dangerous to feel your emotion. So, for example, if I'm with a group of people I don't know, and with a group of people like yourselves who panic a bit when it comes to emotion, I wouldn't feel all of my emotion with you. Do you know why? Half of you want to send me to a doctor to fix me up. I don't want to go to a doctor to fix me up. Right? Some of you have tried feeling emotion in a public place and you've ended up in an ambulance. Yeah. Well, that's why. Right? Now, you've got to question why you wanted to feel the emotion in the public place. Don't talk without the mic. It didn't start off public. But you've got to question, like, why even try to do it? You've got to go away under those circumstances to do it. So you don't force it on other people or anything. You just allow yourself to go through the process. Yep. But yeah, they'll call an ambulance and send you off to a psych ward. Not a problem at all. That's why you don't want to do it. Isn't it? Partly. The worry that you're going to go crazy. The worry that you'll be certifiable, just like Jesus is. Yeah, like I get plenty of emails telling me where I belong. I'm pretty sure if I felt my emotions in front of those people, I'd know where I'd end up too. Right. So what I'm recommending to you is, and if you read through the recommendations we've put in this section, there's quite a number of more recommendations I've made. But you can see that unless we choose to change the way we handle emotion, things are not really going to change. And that process is not a magical process. It's not going to happen without your will being involved, not your willpower. Your will. So there's going to have to develop an aspiration to get to the stage where you want to feel some of this emotion that's inside of you, right? Now, in my case, I had to lose everything and be completely alone before that happened. I lost everything because God's laws deconstruct all of the facade, right? So in the end, once I allowed that to happen, I lost everything. The second thing that happened was I had to allow my emotion to happen. I had to want it even. So I had to get to that stage. So yeah, that's going to probably happen with you, where you get to that stage. Now, you're fortunate because there's other people around you who are okay with you doing that. Some of you are even in a relationship where your partner's okay with that. So the likelihood of you losing everything is far less possible. You know, it's probably not going to happen under those circumstances for some of you. If you do it with a pure desire, you'll find you won't lose much at all. But I found it very hard to develop a pure desire until I lost everything. You know? Yeah. Once that started, you're in business now. You're in business now. And you'll know you're in business too. You will. I've met a few people around the world, just a few, who are actually doing that. Most of them are young. Most of them are in their 20s. And they know they've dealt with stuff. They don't ask me questions like you ask me. They know what to do, know how to deal with it. Sometimes we have discussions about their emotions and what's blocking them and so forth, but they're pretty confident, they know what to do, and how to do it, because they've actually started, there's less terror in them about this because it released some. They've actually gone through a surrender process that we talked about just now. They're quite humble people, very humble people, actually. And as a result, you know, they're making progress. Interestingly enough, there are also people who act. They also finish up creating things related to divine truth that help other people automatically. They've done this after just a few months and sometimes, you know, or a year of knowing divine truth, right? Because they are not blocked by the emotional process. Yeah. And it's not a competition. They're just younger than you or got different blocks than you, or they have a more powerfully developed will than you. And all you need to do is allow those things to develop and it will happen for you too. It's not a competition, but it is something you can measure your own progress, isn't it? You can, if today's better than yesterday type of thing. All right, was there any questions about that before we have a quick break and then our final Q&A? Paul, you would like to ask?
Back at the 2014 assistance group about building the will muscle.
Yep.
So this is relating specifically to that.
Yes. Yeah. Well, remember, I think it was Mary who presented that talk building the will muscle. And if you think about that talk, it was all about developing aspiration, developing desire. So go back to some of that material and have another look at it and think about, okay, I've got to develop a desire to feel emotion here. So how do I do that? What exercise do I need to engage using my will rather than willpower? And also, what blockages do I need to release to begin me on that path? So for many of you, your false beliefs about emotions are prevalent in every discussion we have. You need to let them go. You need to choose to let these false beliefs go. You want to believe them because they stop you from making choices and decisions and taking action. So choose to let them go, these false beliefs. Now, you've been told they're false over and over again. That hasn't changed you. So you obviously believe they're true. So let yourself believe they're true. Experiment with whether they're true or not. Does that make sense? Rather than just believing what I tell you. You're going to need to take some action to experiment with what your current beliefs are, rather than just forcing yourself to believe something that you don't really believe. That makes sense? Yeah. Okay. Well, let's have a break now for 10 minutes, shall we? Come back at 5 to 4. Is that right? Thanks.